So I encourage you to come Sunday night. That's the one.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'll be here one more week in the next couple weeks, and then that's it. So this ministry specifically has always been one that's very close to my heart. And I do care about the people here very much. Even the workers, if you believe that. But just kidding, I like the workers. But man, I always look at this ministry and I just think, what potential? You know, what promise? Jesus Christ came to earth.
Wow, now I'm good.
Can you hear me now?
Alright.
Jesus Christ came to earth because of the Father's will, but there was something in Jesus that saw value in his soul. He saw value in a human life. And I think that's amazing. And so, let me tell you today that I see value. I see potential. You know, maybe some of us are a little rough around the edges. You know, I know I'm still a little rough around the edges, and that's fine. But let me just tell you that Jesus sees value in you. And you have a lifetime of potential you could fulfill just by following his will. So there are many things that I can say. I just want to say that I love you folks. And again, I have, I think, one more week here. And man, I just wish you folks the best, in all sincerity. It's just so exciting to see what could be, you know, with just a young life that started with Jesus Christ. Genesis 22, if you're not there already. Genesis 22. And I don't know why God led me to this passage, but I struggle to say that this might be my favorite passage in the Bible, at least top five. I love this passage. I think it's exciting, I think it's riveting, and I think we should all take some considerations for it. So, Genesis 22. And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham, and said unto him, Abraham, and he said, Behold, here I am. And he said, Take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains, which I will say, which I will tell thee of. And Abraham rose early in the morning, and sat on his ass, and took two of the young men with him, and Isaac his son, and clave the wood for the burnt offering, and rose up. And he went unto the place in which God had told him. Then, on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said unto his young men, Abide ye here with the ass, and I am glad to come yonder and come again. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac his son, and he took the fire in his hand and a knife. And they went both of them together. And Isaac spake unto Abraham his father and said, My father. And he said, Here am I, my son. And he said, Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham said, My son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went both of them together. And they came to the place which God had told them of. And Abraham built an altar there, and laid the wood in order, and bound Isaac his son, and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched forth his hand, and took the knife to slay his son. Let's pray. Lord, there's something here for all of us. There's something very unique. There's something personal here for us. And I'm just asking that your Holy Spirit would come to us today, just move through us, Lord, that we would be affected with our time, that I wouldn't waste time, Lord. And Lord, that this would be a day that we could look back to and say, this is where this spiritual change happened in my life. Lord, I'm looking at a crowd filled with potential. And Lord, may they fulfill it. Not just good jobs and families, being married and those types of things, Lord, but to take it to the next level spiritually. I don't normally do this. Keep your heads down, please. But I have a couple questions for you before the message begins. Heads down, eyes closed. I want you to name the thing in life that you love most. Whatever it is. If it's a mom or a dad, a boyfriend or a girlfriend, a friend, I want you to name it in your mind. I want the picture of that person or that thing to come here. Alright? And my next question is this. It's just a yes or no answer. Yes, raise your hand. No, keep it down. How many people here would say that they love Jesus Christ more than anything in their whole life? Keep your heads down. Raise your hand. Alright. Put your heads down. And you can put your hands down. Thank you. want us to consider these two truths, the thing we love most and our abiding love for the Lord Jesus Christ, and what that really means to us. I think people, in general, want other people to think good things of themselves. Now, we might have a tough guy attitude and say, man, I don't care what people think about me. But the truth is, you kind of do care what people think about you. I care what people think about me. I don't want people to think I'm a liar. I don't want people to think I'm a murderer. I don't want people to think that I'm the kind of guy that's really mean to girls. I care about it. I don't want people to think that about me. And I think if you're really honest to yourself, you can say to yourself, I would prefer, if I had to choose, that people would think good things about me. I think we would all say that, wouldn't we? Nobody likes when people say wrong things about them. Do you like when people say wrong things about you? Have you ever spent time trying to persuade somebody that what they're thinking about me was false? I've spent time and wasted time, and I've come to this conclusion from an earthly perspective. You cannot just go ahead and change somebody's mind about you. They have to come by their own volitional will and decide. You can't forcibly make somebody think something. You can't do it. But you can try to persuade them, and maybe you'll succeed on some level. But the bottom line is, people care about what people think about them. People really care about that. And the fact of the matter is, we can't force people to think something about ourselves. Have you thought about those types of things lately? I remember I was at my football banquet as a sophomore in high school. And I really wanted to please my coach. His name is Coach Putin. And I had purposed that I would like to quit things ever. But I wanted to see something through. And I had purposed right around the third game of the year that I would stop playing football by the time the season was up. I purposed that in my heart. I remember thinking, I'm done with football. I don't want to play it anymore. It's too much for me. It's too much work. I don't want to do it anymore, but I don't want to quit the season. So I already made this decision in my heart. I already decided. I just didn't want to quit midway. So I remember my coach came up to me, and it was at that football banquet. Everything was over. I was kind of looking off to the side. And he came up to me personally. He said, hey, Wesam, so you really saw some good things this year. And are you going to be playing football next year? I remember he asked me. And he was somebody that I so desperately didn't want to disappoint. And I told him, Coach, I will be playing this year. I lied to him. On purpose. You want to know why I lied to him? I didn't want him to think something else about me. I wanted him to think good about me. And I thought about it. I proceeded to not play football the next 3 years. I never played football again. I wrote a letter to my coach my senior year, and I remember apologizing. I remember a couple years ago, you asked me a direct question. I just want to tell you that I'm very sorry. I didn't want to do that. I guess I just didn't want to disappoint you. Something along those lines. The bottom line is, folks, you and I want people to think good of us. We want that. Consider this verse at the very end here, verse number 12. God speaks to Abraham. And God learns something about Abraham. Okay, God knows the beginning from the end. He sees the future. But do you know that he reacts to us on our earthly time? That's part of having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. He reacts to you according to earth time. That's pretty amazing. Look what he says right here. Verse number 12. And he said, lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him, for now I know that thou fearest God. So God's saying, I want you to hurt your son. We all know this story fairly well. We're going to labor through it a little bit. It came time where Abraham, it was clear that he was about to slay his son. God said, now I know that you fear me. Now I know. And so when we look to Abraham's testimony, I think we're asking Abraham, Abraham, do you care what God thinks about you? You know what Abraham would say? Very much so. I do care what God thinks about you. And yes, I think on a personal level, all of us really care about what man thinks about us. We care about what our peers think about us. Maybe we want people to think we're funny. Maybe we want people to think that we're intelligent. Maybe we want people to think that we're some sort of holy person or a tough guy or those types of things. You and I really do care about what people think about us. But I would ask you this one question. Do you care what God thinks about you? Because something occurred to God in verse 12. Now I know. Thou fear me. Now I know. This is amazing. Jesus Christ, on earth time, learned something about Abraham. John 15:2 said this, says this, excuse me, every branch in me that beareth not fruit he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Why did Jesus take Abraham through the fire? Why does he ask him to slay his son? Why does he ask him to do those kinds of things? Because he saw that Abraham was a man of faith, but guess what he wanted to do to Abraham? Make him better. Make him more faithful. Make him more like his son. Make him more holy. Make him those things. So that he could say one day to him, now I know. Now I know. You will have a now I know moment someday. I want you to prepare for that. You will be taken through the fire. You will be taken through the test of Jesus Christ. Will you pass it? So when we consider these types of things, we know that it's sort of a humbling thought that Jesus Christ thinks about us. Jesus Christ reacts to us on earth time. He reacts to us in accordance with our ages. Yes, he's from the eternal spectrum. But you know what he does? He reacts to you and learns things about you. I think that's amazing. I think that's incredible. So, he'll take you through a test. We see that Abraham right here is taken through the test, and he learns something about Abraham. Now, I know. I think that's amazing. The point is this. You and I are going to be taken through a very specific personal test that might not be important to somebody else, but it will be important to you. How you act in that moment will either incur blessing or not. And God in heaven will say, now I know. Now I know. So, what happened that day? How can we learn something about what God took Abraham through? And I want you to have this question in the back of your head. I'm going to ask you a question at the very end of this message, and it's a very difficult question. It's very hard. What is the question that Abraham answered before God? How did God say, now I know? Well, when we look at verses 1 and 2, we see that God deals with the things that we love most. Look what he says here. Take thy son, thy only son, whom thou lovest. Do you know that this is the first time in the Bible that the word love is used? And so we see here something very interesting, that Abraham is in front of God, and he said, I want you to take your son who you love, the only son. Now, we know biologically, Abraham actually had another son named Ishmael. But this is not the son of promise, the Bible says. It's the son of bondage. Yes, he loved Abraham. Yes, Abraham loved him. It's not that he didn't love him, but the promise was through Isaac. The seed of Jesus Christ was going to come through Isaac's line. And so Abraham one day was sitting there before God, and he heard a voice. He heard God's voice and said, I want you to take the son that you love. I want you to take the one that you love most. And he said, you know what? There's something different about a firstborn child. And he went, you know what I'm talking about? With parents, whenever they have their firstborn, it's not that they love their firstborn more than the other ones. It's that they love them differently because this is the promise from God. This is how Abraham loved Isaac. He loved Isaac because this is the fulfillment of the promise itself. And so God says, I want you to take the one that you love. Remember the first question? What is the thing, what is the person, what is the item that you love most? Is it yourself? Is it your mom? Is it your dad? Is it a car? Is it a sport? What is the thing you love most? God's going to ask you about it. He's going to ask you about that item, that person, that thing, that relationship. And he's going to say, I want you to take that son who you love. I want you to take your only son. I want you to take the blessing. It's not even necessarily a bad thing. It's actually a good thing. He's saying, if you love most, that's what I'm going to test you about. So God, we see, deals with the things that we love most. Look what he says here. It's the promise of Isaac. Man, we don't have enough time here because our time is running away from us. But this is the son that Isaac, that Abraham was promised. This was the seed. This was the father of many nations. Because deep down, Abraham had been waiting. Do you know he was 100 when he had Isaac? 100 years old? We don't even know many 100-year-old people here, but this is how long he waited for a son. He was 100. Look, there's nothing wrong with having a son. But there are things that God wants to learn about us, wants to know about us. Look what happens next. God's ways require steps of faith. He rose up early that day, he lifted up his eyes, and he clave the wood, and he said, I want you to take your only son. You know what he did? He brought two men with him. What do we see here? We see that Abraham is ready. We see that he has moments of clarity and that he lifts up his eyes. You know, the Bible talks about how he lifted up his eyes. There are moments in life where you've got to kind of click back in the gear. You've got to lift up your eyes. And Abraham was clear thinking the whole way. There wasn't anything that was wavering about Abraham. I think that's amazing. You know what else he did? He clave the wood. He clave the wood. He brought the wood. He brought the thing that was going to be sacrificing Isaac. Abraham did those things. You know why? He did that in total faith because God told him to do it. Hey, man, I didn't tell you Christian life is going to be a cupcake walk, but it is a cupcake walk if you follow the Spirit of God. We see Abraham here not even wavering. You know what he's doing? Following the impulses of the Holy Ghost. And he's saying, yes, I'm going to be doing that. Yes, I will sacrifice my son. I will lift my eyes up for the moment. I will be ready, and I will bring the wood myself to sacrifice my son, God. I will take the son, you know, I love this. Thy only son. No way. Too much of it. What do we see here? Verses 5 and 6 say, God's ways point back to himself. They point back to himself. Do we see what's happening here? Do we see what's happening? A father sacrificing a son. Do you guys remember about another story in the Bible where a father sacrificed a son, where he pleased the Lord to bruise him? Do you guys remember that? You remember that Jesus Christ actually carried a wooden cross on his back? And this is a picture of that. We see these types of things happening. These things are quite amazing. Here's what else we see. Abraham and Isaac went through it together. So God's going to take you through it past, but he's going to go with you the whole way. It's not like God said, I want you to ask this kid and don't even think about it. Abraham went together with his son. God will always be with you in the test. God will always be with you when he's attempting to learn something about you. We see that God's ways require choice. You know, Abraham had to say yes to the choice of God.
That's right.
You know, Abraham had to agree to all this stuff. Mm-hmm. To agree. I mean, let's really consider this type of thing, because God's ways require the things we love most. Here's what happened one day, some thousands of years ago. A man heard God's voice one day. He said, Abraham, I want you to take thy son, thy only son, whom thou lovest. And he rose up early that day, and he prepared everything. You know what? I imagine that night, and I always imagine Abraham being a lot like the Christians that I know that struggle with decisions, like me. I struggle often with decisions. Can you imagine Abraham? You think maybe he was working very hard that night? You know, sometimes when I'm really frustrated with something, sometimes whenever I'm depressed about something, or my heart is broken over something, you know what I do? I try to do hard labor. I'll go out and just do something hard. I'll try to clean up the house. I have so much energy in those moments. You think Abraham went outside and as the master of this growing nation, you think Abraham went outside and just started to do work his own self? And his servants came up to him and said, oh, Lord Abraham, you don't have to do those things. And he said, no, I got to take care of this now. You think he was out digging? He's like just digging a hole in the ground, just trying to expend this energy that's welling up inside of him. Do you think he tried to do those things? I think probably there was those times in his night, that night himself, he had a hard time sleeping. Don't you think that probably happened? I do. What about this? Do you think maybe he was writing? He was trying to express himself in written form? Or maybe he spent some time in prayer? Do you think that was an easy night for Abraham? Because he knew what he had to do the next day. He had to slay his own son. He had to axe his own son. Thine only son, whom thou lovest. You think that had to happen? Man, I do. Here's what happened. He said, okay, Jesus, I'll go sacrifice my son. So God says, I want you to go to the land of Moriah. The word Moriah means bitterness. Bitterness. I want you to go to this land that means bitterness. And I want you to go to the mountain which I'm going to prepare. So he takes two sons, two other young men, which is another testimony to the witness of two or three people. And he takes his own son, and he brought the wood, and eventually there came a time where he made Isaac carry the wood on his back. And he had the son of the fire on his back, the knife on the fire. So they're trudging up the hill. He says, boys, me and Isaac are going to come back, and we're going to go up and worship. So they trudged up the hill. They climbed up. They kept climbing to the top of this hill. And you think Abraham's heart was just beating the whole time? You think it was just beating because he knew what he had to do? He knew that in just a few short moments, he was about to axe his son. And he was about to do it. You think he was thinking about that? You think there was something in him that was wavering? Because I don't see anything in this Bible that said he wavered for a second. You know what he did? He was about to do it. He was about to slay his own son. Oh my soul, what a scene in Scripture. Whenever I read this, I can't help but cry when I think of this man's faith. So he brought his son Isaac. He laid him down. He said, well, where's the altar, Dad? Where's the lamb? He said, God will provide himself. And he had every opportunity to run away. He had every opportunity. He didn't do it. Quit. He had total faith in Jesus Christ. So they kept walking up this hill. I bet you his heart was just pounding on his chest. I bet you he was sweating. You know, sometimes when I'm stressed out, it's like my body overheats. It's like my hands keep shaking. And I just can't take it anymore because I know it has to happen. It's like I know those moments where God said, "Do you really love me more?" And here's what's the test for him. He gets up there and he gets to the altar of wood. And here's Abraham. He has a knife right here. And he lays Isaac down right on the ground like this. And so he looks at Isaac. And maybe, you ever think that maybe they had that one last weird moment where their eyes meet? You ever say goodbye to somebody and your eyes meet and you don't really know what to say, but your eyes are saying the whole story? Because you have to say goodbye to somebody for the last time? You think they had a goodbye moment like that? You think Abraham looked into his son's eyes and they had that awkward moment where they just kept looking at each other and he's about to take this knife and just run it through his son? You think he had that? Yes, he did have that. And his hand was cocked back. And it was all strength that God himself from heaven said, "Abraham! Abraham! Don't do it. Now I know."
Okay, God. Would have been fine a few minutes ago. I don't know. If that was me, I don't know if I could have done it. I'll be straight up.
But that's what God said. Abraham, now you would spare not your son, and you fear God. That's an interesting word, fear. Fear is a very interesting word in the Bible. It doesn't necessarily mean terrified. Holy fear is a reverence of a divine thing, a divine holy one. And only God deserves our fear. You know what the term fear also appears in the Bible? Love. Passion. Like an enslavement of love. And here are these two things that happen. Consider this for a moment. Verse number 12. And he said, "Lay not thy hand upon thy lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing that thou hast not beheld thy son, thine only son, from me." Fear, love, do they have anything in common? Well, sort of. They really do. Do you know what God's asking you? Here's the question that you and I have to answer for ourselves. Do I really love Jesus Christ more than him? Do I really love Jesus Christ more than my mom, more than my father, more than my brother, more than my sister, more than my boyfriend, more than my kids? Do I really love Jesus Christ more than this? And Jesus Christ from heaven said, "Now I know you fear God." Because that fear was something a little bit more than the love we just heard about. It was love, but it was also this reverential awe for something that is greater than ourselves. Do you love Jesus Christ more than anything in your life? Do you? Maybe you get bored coming to church and keep hearing the same thing over and over. Don't quit, don't quit. Well, here's a slightly different question. Do you love Jesus Christ more than all those things in your life? More than sports, more than friends, more than everything, more than your job that you love, more than your extended family, more than hanging out and just goofing off? Do you love Jesus Christ more than those things? And do you know how Jesus determines that? Through tests and through your actions. You know, when Jesus takes us through the fire like that, our actions show the answer. You know, if you miss church, it's a pretty big deal. It's a pretty big deal that you miss church. Because you're missing what God's going to give you. And you know what Jesus in heaven is looking down and saying when you miss church, when you miss the bus? You know, they really don't love me. And all of us that raised our hands and said, "Yes, we love Jesus more than anything." Maybe that's true on the inside, but in our actions, in our deeds, in the test, because every Sunday morning we have a test, whether we'll get out of the buzzer. Yes, you say you love me, but I don't know if you really do. And what if God from heaven said, "Now I know, when you entered that bus, that you loved me more than sleeping in"? I'm going to be honest. Whenever I hear about people that are too tired or
too sleepy to come to church. I know I should be a little bit more compassionate about it, but I have no respect for it. I'm sorry. I know that other things happen, and people are exhausted sometimes. We're talking about church. Church is so serious. It's important that we come here, because this is where we change. Here's what happened to Abraham. Verse 17 says this, "Then I will bless thee and multiply thee, and I will multiply thy seed as the stars in heaven, as the sand which is upon the seashore, and thy seed shall possess the gates of the enemy. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice." Do you know when we miss out blessings when we just don't even come to church? When we don't pass out a tract? When we don't come to our friends and neighbors and invite them to church? When we don't read our Bible? When we shirk responsibilities like that? Like prayer? Like just being available for somebody? Do you know what it's like? We're telling Jesus, "Yeah, I really do love you, Lord," and in our back of our heads, we know that if a good TV show is on, we would stay home and watch it. Jesus Christ is asking this one question today. Do you really love me more than Isaac? Do you really love me more than your Isaac? Do you really? Because we have responsibility each day to prove that. So that Jesus says, "Now I know. Now I know." Do you know, in Egyptian culture, they used to bury their servants alongside their pharaohs because they thought in the afterlife they would be able to serve them. They would be buried alive. That's pretty much a strong commitment, I'd say. You know, in the Hindu culture, there were things called thuggies, which I thought was kind of a funny word. And in this eccentric religious group in India, that they would jump people all the time because they thought they would pacify the wrath of their goddess Kali. Those types of things. Killing things. They would kill in the name of their god. We're talking about really dark things. You know that the Mayans would see these little limestone sinkholes. They would look at these types of things. You know what they would do? They would push people into it because they thought it was a portal to another world. Because they thought that at the end of it, there was a god waiting to enlighten them. Do you know that they pushed and killed people in the name of their god, which is a false god? And yet God just wants us to tell people that he loves them, and we're shirking that responsibility. And yet God just wants us to not forsake the assembly of ourselves together, as a matter of it. He just wants us to come to church. Simple things. You will have an infinite amount of time to live this life. You have the whole rest of your life ahead. But our times to serve God are just as few. You have only a small opportunity to show God, "Now I know that thou fearest God. Now I do." Think about Abraham. We're almost done. He sacrificed the thing he loved most. A long time ago, God asked me to sacrifice the thing that I loved most. I had some great difficulty with it. But in the end, God's way ended up being the way. And there are other times where God asked me to sacrifice the thing that I loved most. And I did. And I'm not here to tell you that I was like the hero of my illustration. What I want to tell you is, I had a hard time with it. It's not because I came out on the right side. Trust me, I really struggled. It's hard sometimes to do those things. It's hard to do what God wants sometimes, because we want so desperately to do the other thing. But I would invite you to consider Abraham. He made his son carry the wood and was ready to kill him enough that God said, "Abraham, twice, don't do it." Now, I'm certainly not the person who looked to this. Trust me, I'm not. Do you know who is though? Jesus Christ. You know that Jesus did everything that the will of the Father did? Doesn't Isaac look like a picture of Jesus at this point? Doesn't he look like Jesus? He's carrying the cross. But in the end, Isaac wasn't sacrificed, was he? You know what was sacrificed? The ram in the thicket. So here's what happens. Here's how Jesus shows us that he loves us. He spares Isaac. He says, "No, I don't want Isaac to die." And he says, "Now I know that. You would have spared him. You would have killed him." And so here's what happens. Isaac turns into a picture of us because we're spared. And the ram in the thicket, that's Jesus. It's caught in the thicket, the Bible says. It's caught in the sins of this world. It's just like Jesus, who came into this market of sin. Just like Jesus Christ. Jesus says, "Now do you know how much I love you? Do
Do you see? Because Isaac's question was answered. Where is the lamb? And there it was. And Jesus was the lamb. Now the Bible says this. Abraham called it Jehovah Jireh, because in the mouth of the Lord it shall be seen. This is a picture of the manifestation of Jesus Christ in the flesh, because one day it was seen, God's love. Let's have every head bowed, every eyes closed.